God is a good God. Worthy of your praise today. Hallelujah. Come on, you can do better than that. He's worthy of your praise today. Come on, I know it's cold, I know it's snowy, I know it's nice to settle in the warm building, but listen, you gotta stir it up sometimes. And right now, I just encourage you to stir that up because God is longing to do something in your life today. Hallelujah. Father, I just bless you this day. I glorify you this day. Lord, we confess that you are the great I am. Lord, you deserve the highest praise today. Father, you are for us, and who but all can be against us. And so, Lord, I just pray you'll just funnel in this place right now. Then, Lord, you will just move in an extraordinary way. Help us, Lord, to be reminded this morning that you are indeed for us. Hallelujah. 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 I just feel like the Lord wants to remind somebody today that he's not left you. He is with you right this very moment. You've been through some things in your life and some stuff that's kind of set you off balance and off course. But God says, I know the plans that I have for you. He says this morning that I have a direction and a course and a plan for your life if you'll just serve me through this storm. If you'll bless me in the middle of this storm. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Somebody has allowed the issue in your life that I feel like that there's somebody here with diabetes. And the Lord says this morning, you've been personalizing that to where you're calling it my diabetes. You need to stop that. God has not given you that. That is not yours. It's not your identity. It is not who you are. Our identity comes from Jesus Christ. And our identity says that I am healed. In the name of Jesus. So you've got to speak that. You've allowed that identity to come on yourself. And this morning you've got to speak faith. And I'm excited about this series that Pastor's getting ready to start because we've got to access faith. This morning I encourage you to access faith and understand that our God is for you today. Hallelujah. Lord, we worship you this day. We glorify you this day.
You fill me. Aren't you glad this morning that you know God is for you? Now, you didn't hear what I just said. You know God is for you. And you know the scripture says, if God be for us, who can be against us? Paul said, I know in whom I have believed. It's not what you believe, it's who you believe. I know in whom I have believed. And I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed against that day. When you know somebody that is a person of strength and ability, and they love you, they have a tendency to go right in front of you and take care of it before you even get there. I remember years ago, I was in college, and I'd saved up enough money. I needed a car. I saved up, worked and saved up, I mean, just everything I could get my hands on to buy this car. When I went to buy the car, I was still $200 short. And I'm just a kid, I'm 19 years old, whatever it may have been. And the guy at the car dealer, he was there in Wellston, we've known him. Long story short, he said, tell you what, Troy, he said, just take the car, and as you can, pay me the rest, just when you get it. Well, I thought, well, goodness, I'd never bought a car before. I thought, this is great, I can't believe that this guy's just gonna let me take it. I'm still short $200-$250. And I promise you, I'll pay it. He said, well, you don't have to sign nothing. Don't worry about that. Just take it. And I guess a few years later, I was kind of bragging about that and talking about it. And my brother Bob said, what you don't know is, I had already talked to him and told him, let him have it. He's good for it. And if he doesn't pay the money, I'll pay it. So don't worry about it. I thought I'd done something. But Bob, who knew him, had already gone in front of me. Let me tell you something. God, when he's for you, he'll go in front of you. And you think you've really done something when really,
oh, hallelujah,
he already been there. If God be for us, who can be against us? I want you to know he's made a way for you. He's not going to make a way for you. He's already made a way for you. That's for somebody. He's already made a way for you. Just give the Lord a shout of praise and thank him for what he's doing. David Collins, come here a second, will you? I just want you to pray and bless us today. This is a good friend of mine, Pastor David. He travels all over the country preaching the gospel. He used to pastor in Wellston. I just want you to pray and bless us today, will you?
Let's just right now, first thing, let's just say, Lord, we claim the blood today. We put it on in the name of Jesus. Right now we know today that the blood of Jesus will profit us. The blood of Jesus purifies us. And right now today in this house, we just speak out the blood and thank you today for the blood. And ask that the blood of Jesus would be a fresh revelation on everybody's heart and in everybody's mind today. In the name of Jesus Christ, thank you. May this service be a great blessing to everybody here and to our pastor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise God. Don't you appreciate Pastor David? Hey, David, what size are those boots right there? The Lord spoke to me while you were praying. He said, you need to give me those boots. I'm just teasing. He didn't. Lord, forgive me for saying that. Well, give someone a hug right next to you, looking right now, and say, I love you more than you can even begin to know. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord, in the presence of each other. All right, congregation, I want to do something a little different today. How about the weather? What do you think? I believe winter's here now, isn't it? I don't like it. I don't like it at all. You know, the old poem is, whether the weather be good, whether the weather be not, whether the weather be cold, whether the weather be hot, whatever the weather, we'll weather the weather, whether we like it or not. I mean, it's just the way it is. But instead, normally we have the congregation welcome our online congregation. I've got a feeling our online congregation is bigger than our congregation. Online congregation, would you welcome those who have made it out and faced the elements of nature and they're here today? No, welcome our online congregation today and thank God for them. We're thankful for each of you, and this is going to be an exciting year for Life Change Church. I really believe God is going to do some great things, not only here, but online. There's a vast field available right out there of people that need to hear the gospel, that need to be encouraged, and need to attend church somewhere. And maybe they can't get out. Maybe they can't get to the kind of church that they know they need to get to. Maybe there's not one in their area. I don't know, whatever it may be. But every one of us knows someone that needs to be online hearing the gospel preached. So I want you to reach out to somebody, a friend, a family member, and invite them to come right on our webpage, lcchurch.tv, and welcome them to this church. And we're going to reach out in cyberspace and touch souls for Jesus. Our online congregation is growing exponentially. It is an exciting thing, and I want us to embrace it and see God do some great things, not only here as we gather together, but also all who gather with us, wherever you may be. God bless you. We thank you, and we love you for being with us. Now we're going to give. Our ushers get in place. Those of you online, you can give right where you are. Just touch the tab, and we're thankful for how you're faithful to give to the cause of Christ. Father, we thank you and praise you for this offering. I ask, Lord, that you would multiply it for your sake, for your glory. God, that you would use it to touch the hearts and lives of people, that men and women and boys and girls would be convicted of their sin and drawn to the cross. They would find forgiveness and help. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. I want you to open your Bible to Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5, beginning with verse 1, please. Romans chapter 5 and verse 1. We're beginning a sermon series this morning entitled Access. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Would you stand, please? Let us reverence God's word as it is read. Romans chapter 5 and verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we glory in tribulation also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commended his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And I want to direct your attention to verse 2, for there we'll find our text over the next few weeks and basis for remarks in this sermon series, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand. Access. Father, we thank you and we praise you for your word. We thank you, God, that you are faithful to speak to us. And I pray that each of us will have ears to hear what the Holy Spirit has to say. And I ask, God, that you would challenge us today, that you would put your thumb in our back and push us forward. Help us, God, be that which you want us to be and accomplish all that you want us to accomplish. And we'll praise you forever. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 You may be seated. A number of years ago, it was a Saturday afternoon, and I went to start my car. I'd been pastoring just a couple years, perhaps. I was 23, 24 years old. I'd gone to start my car, and the car wouldn't start. I called the mechanic, and he came out and said, well, we're going to have to get to my garage. And there I was without a car. I went to church that Sunday and was talking to some fellas. There was an older guy in the church there that I pastored. He had just retired. He was a truck driver, and he had a brand new truck, and he had just bought a brand new car. It was the Crown Victoria. Nice car. Wasn't a bad car. Wasn't something that a young man would, choose as a car, but it was a car that he had. And he said, you know, Pastor, I very rarely drive my brand new car, and while yours is being fixed, if you would like to, you can borrow my car. Well, I said, Don, I really appreciate that. I think I'll take you up on it. I wasn't sure what I was going to do, if I was going to have to rent a car. He said, no, don't worry about that. Just take my car for the week. I'll bring it to you tonight, and I'll get my brother to take me home after church. So that night, he brought the car, and the mechanic had called that day and said, Troy, we're going to need this much money to fix your car. We'll have it for about a week. I said, well, I'll go to the bank machine after church, and I'll get you the money. I drove to the bank machine in that car, and when I got out of the car, I did not know that this car, if you got out of it and left it running, it would lock itself. Well, there I stood in the middle of the night at a bank machine in South Columbus. Now, if you've ever been in South Columbus in the middle of the night at a bank machine, that's not exactly a desirable place to be, if you know what I'm talking about. And there I stood, and when I went back to get in the car, I lifted the handle to no avail. I was locked out. Well, here it is. I've got this car. It's a Crown Victoria. Had a V8 engine in it. Would run pretty good. Had electric seats, power steering, power everything, a nice radio. Anything you can imagine you'd want in a car, there it sat. Sitting there, running and idling. And I was on the outside of it, looking at it, and realizing I can do nothing with it because I'm locked out. I realized as I stood there that evening
that I knew a lot of people that went to my church that lived that way every single day. Right in front of them was all kind of power and help and grace and ability that they could have, but in reality, they were standing on the outside of it, listening to the engine as it idled, and they could do nothing about it. I didn't know what to do. So I remembered his number, and down the way was a payphone. Now, you're not going to find many of those today, but I found one that night. That's been a lot of years ago. And I went and I called Don. I said, "Don, I hate to tell you, I've locked myself out of the car. It's sitting here running at Fifth Third Bank, South High Street. And I hate this, but I'm afraid you're going to have to come and help me." He said, "We got this." I said, "What is it?" He said, "On the door are some numbers. I'm going to give you four numbers. You go punch those numbers in, and the door will unlock, and you'll get in." I said, "Don, I appreciate this so very much." He gave me the numbers. I ran back to that car sitting there idling. I punched the numbers. The door unlocked. I got in, and down the road I went, accessing all the availability that car gave me to do whatever I needed to do. Do you understand that there is a lot of grace available for you as a Christian?
Come on. Amen.
There's a lot of power available for you as a Christian, but you have been on the outside looking at it. But in the coming weeks, I'm going to teach us from God's Word how we can unlock the door, how we can access God's grace in our life. Paul promised us this in Romans chapter 5 and verse 2, when he said, "We have access by faith into God's grace." Now listen to that. What is the grace of God? It is the unmerited favor, supernatural strength of God released in our lives. Now hear that. He said, "We have access at any time to the unmerited favor, supernatural strength of God in our lives." Now, can I just ask you, do you think you might be living a little bit better place than you're living right now if you knew you could access the unmerited favor?
Come on.
Supernatural strength of God at any moment. Do you suppose that you might accomplish more in life and even spiritually if you understood how to access the unmerited favor of God? I want you to know that the resource of God's favor in our life is more valuable than anything on this earth. If Donald Trump walked in here and decided to take 10 minutes away from his candidacy to run for president, just to look at you and say, "You can access everything I have," it's at your disposal for the next 2 hours. I'm going to tell you what I would do. The first thing I would do is buy any car that I want. The second thing I would do is I'd pay the farm off. The third thing I would do is I would buy a lot of gift certificates to Jeff Ruby. Somewhere down the line, maybe about 55, I might buy Mandy a horse. Think about this. Think about what kind of relief it would be if Donald Trump walked in there and laid his checkbook in front of you and said, "You can access all that I have for the next 2 hours." What could you accomplish? What would you do? Listen, you have right in front of you a lot more availability than anything Donald Trump can give you. We have at our fingertips, at any moment, the supernatural strength, the unmerited favor of God. Paul said we can access God's grace. The same grace that saves us is available to us right this moment. How do we do it? I'm going to give you the first one today. He says that we access God's grace by faith. But not just faith. What kind of faith? What's the combination? There's not a combination, but if there were, what would the Word of God outline for us? I'm going to give it to you. Number one, if we're going to access the grace of God, it's going to take faith that is willing to step. Faith that's willing to step. Faith is not dormant. It's not inactive. It's not, I'm going to wait around and hope God does something. No, faith is something that's active. It drives us towards something. It requires us to take some kind of action. Faith, if it's anything, it always steps. Remember back in the Old Testament when they were going to go from the wilderness into the land of promise? What did God say to Joshua? Get the priest, have them bear the Ark of the Covenant. When you come to the swelling tide of the Jordan River at spring high tide, here's what I want you to do. I want the priest to step into the water. And when their feet touch the brim of the waters will part and you will access the supernatural provision, yes, favor, yes, strength of God. And so when they came to the river, you remember exactly what God had said? That's what they did. And the priest bearing the Ark of the Covenant stepped into the water. And as soon as their foot touched the brim of the water, the waters parted and they walked across on dry land. If we're going to access God's grace, we've got to be willing to step.
Come on.
Now, most of us, what we want is God to do something, and then we step. And God says, no, you step, and then I'll do something. Anybody can step into the Jordan River after he parts it. It takes faith to step into the water when it's still.
Amen. That's right. Preaching good.
Amen.
It's not faith to react to what God does. It is faith to believe what God will do by my obedience in stepping out. I just said something. You sit around and say, oh, God, I believe you if you would just do something. And God says, if you believe me, you would do something. I'm preaching so good I can't stand it. I hope you online are really saying amen a lot. You know what I'm saying? Please stay with me. I'm talking to the people online because I'm not even sure you're here right now. Listen to me. No, we've got to be willing to step. Step. Now, really, you could take stepping to three things. You step out, you step in, you step on. Now, this is all introduction. I'm going somewhere. Just stay with me. I'm going to teach you how to do this in just a moment. You step out. In other words, if you want God's strength, you got to be willing to step out of your strength. If you want God's power, you got to be willing to step out of your power. If you want God's intellect, you got to step out of yours. If you want God's... If you are self-reliant, then all you ever get is what you can bring. If you are self-reliant, listen to me. If you are struggling with something, hear this and hear it well. If you think, I'm going to beat this thing, if you are self-reliant, then you will produce all that you can produce. And by the way, when it comes to sin, none of you can beat it. Nobody can beat sin. The moment you think, I've got this, it has you in such a way that you have no idea how hard and how bad it has you. No, faith says I'm going to step out of one realm and I'm going to step into another realm. I'm going to step out of my strength and step into his strength. I'm going to step out of my power and step into his power. I'm going to step out of what I can do and step into what God can do. I want God kind of results, not Troy Ervin kind of results. I want what God can bring, not what I can bring. I want to... In any arena of life, we are people of faith, and we never get what God wants us to have by sitting idle and hoping God does something. Hope is a wonderful thing. It's something that we have for the future. But faith is something we have for the present. We have the hope that Jesus will come back, but faith is, I know that Jesus is working in my life right now. We have the hope that next year is going to be great, but I have the faith that right now, and I'm preaching good. And I need to be willing to step out of what I am doing and into what He's doing. And I need to be willing to step on to the truth of His Word. All right, here's what I want to preach. That's all introduction. You still with me?
Yeah.
I don't believe it. I want to read something to you real quick. I'm going to teach you how to do this. Because, now listen to me. And hear me. Listen to me. I'm not talking about fanaticism. I'm not talking about stepping out on every whim. I'm not talking about, well, God said if I just step out in faith, that great things could happen. Well, you might step out and accomplish nothing.
Right.
Hear me. That I'm not talking about just you in some humanistic man effort, pie in the sky, this is my dream. I'm not talking about something that you do and God honors what you're doing. I'm going to explain what faith is when you step out. Are you ready? I'm going to read it to you. There's a great story in the New Testament. In Matthew chapter 15, it's also in Mark chapter 6, or one similar to it. Matthew 15, verse 22. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get in a ship and go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with the waves, for the wind was contrary. Don't you find it interesting that Jesus will send you right into problems?
Yes.
I said, Jesus said, you get on that boat and go on over. Isn't that crazy? I forgot my new glasses. These aren't my bifocals. I got to do this. Does that look stupid? I don't want your trifocals. Jesus sent him right into a storm. Now listen, in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a spirit, and they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, or if it's you, let me, bid me come unto you on the water. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink. He cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore did you doubt? And when they were coming to the ship, the wind ceased. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. Now, you got something to write with, you ought to write this down. If you're going to step out in faith and access the supernatural grace of God, are you ready? If you're going to step out. Number one, everyone say number one.
Number one.
Number one.
Number one.
Number one.
You guys are horrible. If you're going to access the grace of God,
number one.
Thank you. Here's what has to happen. You got to make sure it's Jesus.
Yes.
I'm not saying just anything. I'm not saying, well, I'd really like to be or have that, so I'm going to step out. No, make sure it's God.
Yes.
A lot of people irresponsibly step out and braggingly, boisterously, step out, I'm going to do this for God. And let me explain something. We do nothing for God. We only do things with God.
Yes. Amen.
We are crazy to think. I understand we say it and what we mean by when we say it. I get it, that I'm going to do this for God. I understand that. And it's important that your motive and pure and all that. I get all that. But the reality is you can do nothing for God. You can only do something with God. And if you step out to do something for God and God's not there, yeah, you're going to lose big. We can access the grace of God in our life, but you better know when you start stepping. Here's Peter on the boat. Jesus is walking on the water. And I just think it's incredible what Peter shows us on how to step out in faith. We learn how to step out in faith here. Listen to what happened. Jesus said, don't be afraid. It's me. It's all good. It's me. It's me. And then Peter said, now, Lord, if it's really you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, just said it was him. I want to tell you something. If you're going to step out of the boat, you might want to confirm the fact. Thank you. I appreciate that. He said that was good preaching. I just appreciate that. No, if you're going to step out in faith, you might want to confirm the fact. I mean, Jesus had already said, it's me, don't be afraid. And Peter says, if it's really you, Lord, you want to go on some venture? You going to step out and believe in God to do something supernatural? First thing you better figure out is this God?
That's excellent. Amen. That's the Lord.
Is this my emotion? Is this just something I want to try? Is this just something I want to do?
Come on. Yes, sir. You have to figure that out.
I want to tell you something. This week, when God gave me this series to preach, I couldn't wait to preach it.
Yeah,
now that I'm here, I still can't wait to preach it. You better make sure it's God.
Amen.
Not man. Not what some fella's telling you to do. Not the church. Not religion. Not your own emotion. Not your own thought. No, make sure it is God.
Amen.
I remember when God was calling me to preach, I wanted to make sure it was God. I heard people tell me when I was a little boy, you're going to be a preacher. Sunday school teachers, you're going to be a preacher. Preachers, you're going to be a preacher. My own mother, you're going to be a people. Oh, you're going to be a preacher. I want to tell you something. When it came right down to doing it, I didn't want to hear my mom's voice. I didn't want to hear A.B. Malloy's voice. I didn't want to hear a Sunday school teacher's voice. I wanted to know, is God walking on the water here? I don't want to step out and do something on my own. Amen. I don't want to try this stuff on my own. I want to know, is Jesus Christ out there in the middle of this storm walking on the water? And I will tell you this, we got to get to the place that we've got the kind of faith that if it is Jesus walking on the water, there ain't no devil out of hell can keep us in the boat. There ain't nobody going to hold us back at that point.
Amen. Amen.
Hmm? Oh, I'm preaching good right now. Number one, what do we do?
Make sure it's God.
Make sure it's God.
You still with me?
Yeah.
You're going to access the supernatural grace of God in your life. Make sure whatever it is you're stepping toward, make sure it's God. Number two.
Number two.
All right, thank you. I had to give you a better cue, I suppose. I looked at myself on camera just now. I realized Christmas just caught up with me. I won't be able to eat nothing this week except for pizza and Skyline. Secondly, not only make sure it's God, secondly, wait for God to say something. The biggest problem that I've had in life, and you have too, is sometimes we even know it's God, but we get ahead of him. I love what Peter does here. When accessing the something supernatural to do what nobody else has even done before or since. Peter does something here that no one's ever done before or since. Yes. He accessed the grace of God. He made sure it was Jesus. Secondly, he waited to hear Jesus speak. Listen to what happened. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it's you, tell me to come out there. He didn't say, all right, Lord, I'm coming. No, he said, if it's you, then say something to me.
Yeah. How precious.
Say something to me. Listen, don't step until Jesus says, come. We get all zealous and all excited. And all, this is what we're going to do. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. Let me tell you something. This is not my first rodeo. I've made a ton of mistakes. I will tell you this. I have swam a lot more than I've walked on water. Jay Fry, you know you have too. You need to hear me. You don't want to get ahead of the Word of God. Peter's still in the boat. He says, Lord, if it's you, then bid me come. And Jesus, his piercing voice through the storm, and it rings in the ears of Peter. Faith comes by
hearing.
Hearing by the Word of God. He says, come! God doesn't have to say a lot for you to do a lot. The thing I love about God is he says little and does a lot, and we say a lot and do little. Are you still here? Come! And Peter stepped out in faith and accessed the strength and power of Christ. Think about this a minute. When he knew it was God and he heard the voice of God speak and the word of God was given, Peter, by stepping out in faith, accessed the same kind of ability that Christ was operating in when he walked on water. Because Peter did the same thing that God was doing.
Absolutely. That's good. Amen.
I wish you heard what I just said.
Huh?
You don't like the result. Look at me. You don't like the results in your life? You understand you're getting the results that you're doing.
Yes.
If you want God's results, make sure he's out there. Let him speak his word. Get in the Bible and get you a scripture to stand on. And you can step out and then you'll be doing what God does. Peter. Peter. I think you got to get a hold of this. Peter walked on water. Go try that today. Just get down there. Go down there and will yourself. I'm going to the high river this afternoon. And by self-will and absolute determination of my own mental capacities and strength in my body, I am going to walk across the Ohio River over into Kentucky. Go do that. Huh? If you're going to do that, please let me know. I'm going to show up with my iPhone. It will be on Facebook. I want to tell you something. If Jesus is on the other side of the river, and he says, come,
yeah.
Yes.
We can do supernatural things, things that's beyond our own capability, not by our force of will and determination and strength and prowess of personality. No, we can do it when we know God is out there and when we hear God say, come on. I'm going to tell you something right now. Every time I've ever preached the last 26, going on 27 years, I have walked on water because I know what I can do.
Right, right.
And trust me when I tell you, it is not this.
Right.
Even the idea of being in front of people. When I was little, I was as shy as you. I wouldn't speak to nobody when I went to school. I was as shy as you can be. The idea that God would say, Troy Ervin, preach, and set me up in front of a crowd of people to do this, I want to tell you something. It is absolutely impossible. You might as well take me down there and say, walk across the Ohio River on the water. It's the same deal. But I can tell you this. I knew it was God, and then he gave me his word. And the last 26, 27 years, every time I've ever walked into a pulpit, absolutely, by his grace and by his strength, I have walked on water.
Yes, sir.
I can't build a church. And I'll tell you this. The moment you think you know how to build one, you are on dangerous ground.
Yeah.
I can't build a church. I don't know how to do it. I can't put X, Y, Z in place and all of a sudden it just have a wonderful thing happen. I cannot do any of that.
Right.
And I'll tell you, nobody can do anything unless God is in front of you,
yes,
doing it.
Yes.
Unless God build it, it will be built in vain.
Amen.
That's why I'm just going to rest and take comfort. God wants to build a church, he can build a church. If he don't want to build one, he don't have to build one. If he wants to have 1,000 people, then we can have 1,000. And if he wants us to have 150, then I'll come in and preach to 150. My only responsibility is to say, is it God out there? And does he want me to get out of the boat? All the rest of it's up to him.
Right.
Do you hear me? I'm just simply telling you, faith steps out into what God wants you to do.
Amen.
He said to Peter, come on. Come on.
It's good.
I can't wait till spring.
Good.
Make sure when you step out on faith, make sure it's God. Make sure you wait for God to say something. He'll say it through his word. He'll say it through his spirit. I don't even preach until I find out what God wants me to say.
What a joy.
And that's the truth. There have been many times the last 27 years, even in preaching, there have been many times, and Pastor David, you can testify this, and anybody else that's ever preached and truly preached the gospel, and many times that I walked the pulpit and said, I don't have anything. I got tons of sermons, but I don't have anything. There's a difference in having a sermon and having something.
Right. Big difference.
Hmm? I remember one time I was in an awful mess. Had a revival service I was in, Chris, and a big crowd. And I didn't have nothing. Had a lot of sermons, but I didn't have it. And I just walked the pulpit. I said, I'm going to be honest with you, folks. I don't have anything. They taught me not to do this, but I'm going to go against the rules. I don't have anything. I could make something up or rehearse, regurgitate something that I already ate. You really don't want that. You guys aren't paying attention to anything I'm saying. Huh? Leftovers are good out of the fridge, but they're not very good out of here. Amen. I like leftovers out of the fridge, don't you? Some good cold chicken at 2:00 in the morning, that's wonderful, but I don't like it when it's coming up the other way. And there are some sermons, they're pretty good when you get them out of the fridge, but when they come out the other way, I've heard some of them preaching, I thought, good night, I didn't want to hear that. Pretty good the first time. I'm telling the truth. I said, I don't have nothing. It was an awful feeling, but I just didn't. Because I can't go unless God's there, unless he's speaking. And God did something else that night, and they lined the altars. It was a tremendous service, and we had a wonderful time. Make sure it's God. Wait for him to say something. Jesus said to Peter, come. Let me give you this one. Are you still here?
Yeah.
This is good. Continue with Jesus as the focal point. Continue with Jesus as the focal point. You're going to step out. Continue with Jesus. We make a huge mistake when we step out and we know it's God. And God tells us to come. We hear his voice and we have his word. We make a huge mistake. Then we start looking to other things.
Right.
Right.
Or depending on the other wrong things.
Right.
Listen to me. You get your eyes off of Jesus, the focal point, and look at fear or faith in man. You understand, whenever Peter saw the wind, his faith shifted from his confidence in Christ to his confidence in himself. It shifted from the ability of Christ to the ability of Peter. Let me say this over here. When Peter got his eyes off of the focal point, his ability shifted from the ability of Christ being released in him to do something he could have never done to his own ability to not be able to do anything. And that's what will happen to you. You get your eyes off the focal point, you get your eyes off of Christ, that step that you've taken, you are now out in the water, and you will go from the ability of Christ to the ability of man. And anything, listen, anything that becomes your focal point other than Christ will cause you to sink.
Amen. That's the truth.
Amen.
That's the truth. Oh, God, help us.
Anything. That includes yourself. See, we say it was the wind. Yeah. It wasn't the wind that caused Peter to sink. It wasn't even the fact that he wasn't like physically looking at Jesus. It's not that he wasn't. I believe, you can just correct me if I'm wrong, I believe he could have watched the wind the whole time if his heart stayed on Christ.
Right.
It wasn't the fact that he shifted his eyes from Jesus to the wind. It's that he shifted his faith from Christ to him. This is so good. And you see it in the fact that he was fearful. When we are afraid, when we are fearful, that means we're putting faith in ourselves. But when our faith is fixed in Christ, I want to tell you something. No wind, no devil, no person, no, it doesn't matter what anybody, we're just walking right on that water, brother. The fear exposed the fact that his faith had shifted from Christ to himself. Now, let's not be too hard on old Peter, though. Please. Because he hadn't done anything that we all haven't done a number of times. And furthermore, you know, it's real easy for us to sit around and give Peter what for. And I just want to remind you, you can give him what for. But the fact is, he still did something that none of us ain't never done. That ain't a pretty way to say it, but I'll say it that way again anyway. He still did something ain't none of us ain't never done. Peter actually did walk on water. You ever done that? He walked on water. It's easy to sit in the boat and criticize the person trying to do something. I have no problem with you sinking. As a matter of fact, I'd love to see every one of you screaming for air. I would love it. That's a lot better than you having a seminar on faith on the boat. Amen. It's one thing to sit around on Sunday morning and talk about faith. It's a whole other matter to say, I'm going to get out of this boat and I'm going to get my eyes on Jesus and I'm going to make sure it's God. I'm going to hear His word. He's going to speak to me and I'm going to do something that I could have never done. I'm going to accomplish something that I could have never accomplished. I'm going to be something I could have never been. I'm going to kick something I could have never kicked. I'm going to go someplace I could have never gone on my own strength and on my own power. I, in this life, will walk on water supernaturally as my eyes are on Christ. My heart is fixed in faith in Him, and it's impossible to fail when I'm using His strength and not my own.
Amen. That's the truth.
Possible.
That's the truth.
I'm not going to criticize Him, though, because we've all done it. We've all sunk. I'll tell you, buddy, there have been many times in my life I didn't just sink. I went ahead and bought me a pair of cinder block shoes. You know what I'm talking about? Put a Nike swoosh on them and everything else. I've cinder block all the way. I went down fast. I guess I'm the only one. Kid yourself. I hear a lot of gurgling in here this morning. Some of you spitting up some water right now. Nah, I'm not going to criticize Peter. One thing I do like about him, though, he had the presence of mind and the resolve of heart to realize who he needed in his life. He said, Lord, save me! And Jesus reached down and saved him. And together, they walked back on the water. Listen to me. I am not a religionist. I don't know if that's a word or not, but I'm not religious. A lot of religious people say, if you sink, well, you're going to have to earn it now. You're going to have to prove yourself. You ever heard people say that? You let someone, let a brother fall or mess up or sink. You're going to have to earn it now. You're going to have to prove yourself. You're going to have to swim. Jesus didn't do that. Peter sunk. And Jesus picked him up and said, okay, let's walk back in the boat together. Jesus could have walked and said, well, there you go, boy. You made your bed, lay in it. Huh? Good luck with it. I'll be on the boat if you need anything. No. I love the fact I'm preaching a lot of stuff here today that you don't even appreciate. I'm going to find a church that just loves me. That's what I'm going to do. I'm just teasing with you. I'm joking. I love you. Now listen to me. I appreciate the fact that Jesus did not make him swim. But in the very place he sunk, he picked him up and he continued on from that very spot, walking on the water. We can learn from that. You see it happen spiritually in the life of Peter. That's a physical illustration in Peter's life of what happened later on spiritually with Peter. When he stood beside a little fire and there was a little lady saying, you're one of them. He said, I'm not one of them. I'm not one of them. She said, I know you're one of them. You even sound like them. And so he started cussing like a drunken sailor to guys. His Christianity. The Bible says he went out and wept bitterly. He sunk. But when Jesus resurrected from the dead, he looked at the ladies and said, now you boys, listen to me. You go get the rest of those disciples. And he said, also, Peter. And Peter, I'm going to tell you something. Had he been around in this day and age, he'd have had to wait a couple years before he preached on the day of Pentecost.
Yes, sir. Preaching. Yeah. Yes, sir.
They'd have made him swim for a little while.
Yeah.
The church would.
Yes, sir.
Haven't you ever noticed people on the boat always make people sink and swim? The rest of that crowd's still on the boat. And they're going. I have seen this my whole life. People criticizing those people walking on the water because they sunk. And trying to strap more on them. They don't throw a life preserver out there. They throw a vest with lead weight in it. Now, we need to learn. We need to learn from Jesus. He did not make Peter swim back to the boat. He picked him up and said, let's walk. And when Peter denied the Lord three times and sank spiritually, when Jesus resurrected from the dead, out of the caverns of death he come. And when he did, he brought Peter back up with him and said, let's keep walking on water together. I'm preaching the truth right now. And Peter walked out on water on the day of Pentecost and looked at that crowd and said, you killed him, but God raised him from the dead, and the sun's going to turn to blood, or the moon's going to turn to blood, and the sun's going to be dark, and the stars going to shake and fall from the heavens. And they said, what do we do? He said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus for the remission of sin. And the gospel was preached, and 3,000 people got saved in one sermon. Peter.
Praise the name of God.
I can tell you this, I've sunk more times than I want to talk about, but Jesus, man, put a lot on me, but Jesus has never made me swim. He always just picked me up, said, come on, boy, let's walk back together. We're going to be all right. We're going to be all right. Let's do what only I can do through you. Let me remind you, Peter, you can walk on water if I'm the focal point. If you and I, listen to me, wherever you are in life, and I'm finished with this, I've got to quit. It's just a little bit after 11, and I'm not keeping you very long today. But listen to me, if you and I will make Christ the center of our life, if His will be preeminent over everything else, if Christ will be the center, the focal point of it all, then we can accomplish anything He tells us to accomplish. I was talking to Alex yesterday. We were in the car. Alex is, he has a lot of me, has a lot of his papa in him, and regrettably he's got a lot of his mother. I love his mother, but they are so squirrely. You know what I mean? They just see squirrels constantly. You can't get, you're talking about something, you might be talking about something important. So-and-so has cancer. What? I'm just teasing. It's hard to get, you know what I'm talking about? They constantly, squirrel! ADD. They haven't made a medicine yet that'll fix them. If they had, I'd buy it. I'd mortgage the house again to buy it. But I was talking to Alex. Alex loves sports, and he's a good athlete. He really is for his age. He did a couple things playing basketball yesterday. He goes up and does this little floater. It looked exactly like something his papa would have done back in the day. Nowadays, Gabby goes up. He it's only about that far off the ground. And when he comes back down, he's down a lot longer. But Gabby, man, he was an incredible basketball player. And Alex did this little floater shot. And it's just Gabby Smith written all over it. And then a little bit later, he went down and made this move and passed it over his head. He's 10 years old, just turned 10, passed it over his head to no-look pass to some kid. And that's something I would do. And Gabby, as a coach, if you'd do that, he'd hurt you for doing that. It was so funny. But on the way there, Don Crooks, it was so cute. Alex is always talking about, when he grows up, he's going to be a professional baseball player or a professional football player or a professional basketball player. And he told me one day, I said, what do you want to be when you grow up? He said, I want to have a nonprofit organization to help people. I said, that's incredible, son. I mean, my heart was glowing when he said that. He just wants to help people. And he said, but I'm going to finance it by playing professional football. I said, well, all right. I like it. But it was so cute yesterday. He was talking about being a professional, whatever. And all the rest of it. And I said to him, son, remember something. He said, what? I said, Oh, that's good. And maybe, just maybe, God will call you into a life to where you can shine like a star on a basketball floor, on a football field to bring him glory. Maybe he'll give you the ability and ask you to do that kind of thing. I said, but here's the bottom line, Alex. If God wanted you to run a little mission down in Cincinnati and you barely have any money, but you run that mission and tell what God wants you to do, that's all that really matters.
Right.
What does God want in your life?
Amen.
If God wants you to be a pro athlete, then I'll be so proud of you. But if God wants you to do something else, you do what God wants you to do. You hear what I'm saying? Faith doesn't work when it's just something out here, some spirit walking on the water. Faith works when it's Jesus saying, this is my will for you. Step out. And you be, I said, if you'll make him the focal point, Alex, then your life will be what it's supposed to be. Just that simple. He kind of smiled. He said, I hear you, Dad. I hear you, Dad. And that's exactly the truth for all of us. Oh, how often do we get, I'm preaching to myself and I'm preaching to you. How often do we get our eyes and our heart off the focal point? Make sure it's God. Wait for God to say something. Continue to look to Jesus. Stand with me. I've kept you long enough. Here's what I want to do. This is a good place to practice stepping out. You're not going to step out and do something great for Jesus if you can't step out and go to an altar and pray. Maybe you're here today and you would say, preacher, I've stepped out many times. It just seems like I keep sinking. I want to encourage you to call out on Jesus' name. He won't make you swim back. He'll walk with you to the boat. Maybe you're here today and you say, I've been fearful. There's something I know God wants me to do or God wants me to be, whatever. You say, I need to pray about it. You might be here today and you have a specific call in your life. I just feel this on my heart, just like I was talking about with Alex. You might have a specific call in your life, like when he called me to preach. I don't know. And you say, I've just been wrestling with a specific call. Listen to me. When you are out of his will, look at me. When you are out of his will, nothing will go right in your life. When you are in his will, it doesn't mean everything will go right, but it does mean you will always be able to step out and access his grace by faith. If you're here today and you say, I need to pray, the Holy Spirit is dealing with my heart, who right now on purpose would step out of your seat and onto the Word of God and come to this altar and say, I'm going to let God do something in my heart and in my life. Step out right now. Go ahead and sing.
Oh, to Jesus I surrender all to him.
I don't care how many times
I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior.
Started preaching. Everybody look at me. I'm going to let you go, but you got to hear this. I first started preaching. My first year of preaching out of Shannon, I was in college, in Circleville Bible College, High Christian University now. And I got a job there in town. I worked that job. I went to school full time, and I preached. That year, Elder Shannon, I had one revival. It was my first revival I ever preached, just outside of Parkersburg, West Virginia, in Boaz, West Virginia. A little church. But I had places to preach every week, a Wednesday night or a Sunday night. Just about every week I preached somewhere, doors opened. going into my sophomore year, you got to understand, I come from nothing. We had no money. Mom had nothing to give me. I had to make it on my own. That was it. And God put on my heart, Elder Shannon, and it was so contrary to even how I would have been raised. He put on my heart because I was going to go back into town and get a job at one of the places that would hire me. The one place said I could come back there. I was going to work that job and go to school full time and preach. God, my sophomore year, put on my heart. It was Jesus on the water. He said, don't do it. He said, step out in faith and believe that I'm going to provide for you. That's what I told him. Chris, my freshman year, I preached one revival. From my sophomore year to my senior year, Don Crooks, I preached 125 more revivals as a kid. Now, you know that's a total God thing. I mean, these are all regular adult, I mean, nothing against anything else, but they were revivals in churches and camp meetings. And God opened up doors. Now, here's the kicker. I never one time asked anybody, can I come to your church and preach? I still to this day don't have a business card for preaching. I didn't send out a letter. I'm not saying it's wrong to do that. I'm telling you what happened with me. I stepped out in faith and said, God, I believe it's you on the water. You're telling me what to do, and I'll do it. And children, God provided everything for me and opened up doors that I could have never opened up myself. All by faith. He did what he could do. And to this day, when it comes to preaching, to this day, I've never asked one church or one place, can I preach? Can I come to your church? I've never one time done that. Even this church. When I came to pastor here, I didn't ask, can I come here to pastor? No, I've never asked for a pulpit. God has always provided. Do you hear what I'm saying? Faith. Faith. It's the best thing we've got.
Amen.
It's the best asset we've got. Because it is faith that's willing to step that will access the grace of God.
All right. Amen.
I'm going to let you go home. I love you guys. I hope you love me more than I love you. You have a wonderful day. Please be careful on the slick roads. Going down this hill, just act like it's a sled. Just go as fast as you can. Enjoy yourself. I love you. God bless you. You're dismissed.